Welcome students. Today we are going to start with block transfer. Now first we'll see what do you mean by block, and then we'll see how to transfer the data from one block to the other block. So to start with, block is something continuous memory allocation. Suppose you want to save, you have saved the data in a sequential manner, so you can name or you can access to that respective numbers or that data with some memory locations, and that memory location, if it is continuous in nature, then that some specific count is referred as one block. So here same, we need to work on any specific block where we will consider one of the block as source and other as destination. So whatever the content of the source, that should be completely get transferred to the destination. So this is our target. So now this instruction, that this program can be implemented in various iterations, like or its various combinations, like there can be overlapped and non-overlapped type of block, and you can use string instruction, and without string instruction also the block transfer is possible. So to start with, very basic, we'll see the non-overlap block transfer without string instruction. So before that, we need to define the block of data. So yes, if that value is known to us, then obviously it will be the part of section dot data. So we'll define it. Suppose S block, the name which I am giving, and that data, individual data, is of 1 byte, and suppose it is storing the numbers like 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Take any random number. For example, my block contains this 7 numbers, right? So this is my source block. Now where I want to transfer this, that block is also I need to define. So I can define it. Initially I will make those contain 0, so that after transfer, how it is going to replace, that I can figure out clearly. So destination block can be defined like this. So whatever the size of your source, that is 7, that should be the size of your destination. This is the one possible way to declare. But if you see here, all the values are same and it is repeating n number of times. So the other way to define it is like using the keywords times. How many times you want to repeat? What is the size of the individual element and what is its value? So like that you can also define the destination block. Okay. Now we'll work on how to transfer from one block to other. So first we'll clear the logic. So for example, we'll work on the some random values, like suppose here the numbers are like 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. From this, I want to transfer my content to this destination block whose values are initially 0. Now this block values I can refer only when I have this memory locations with me. So first we'll store its base address into our indexing register. So RSI and RDI are the two available indexing registers with us. So like that, RSI we can point to the source block and RDI we can point to the destination block. Now to transfer the content, we have instruction called as move, MOV. But the limitation of move is what? We cannot directly transfer the data from one memory location to the other. So in between, you need to have some kind of any other type of operand, and that can be one of the register. So let's consider in between, you have some accumulator with you. AL, I have taken the size because I am considering this element size is 1 byte. So what, how you will transfer the data from RSI to AL? First you will transfer your data, and then from AL to RDI you will move your data. And so like that, your value can be here 1. If I want to transfer the next value, so what I need to do? I need to just increment my RSI and increment my RDI. And again repeat the same, transferring content to the AL from AL to this RDI. So the same logic we are going to write in terms of the procedure. So first we'll write the procedure. Suppose I am giving the name for that procedure as block transfer. So what we require? We require RSI RDI at the proper location. So we will point RSI to S block, because this is the same block which we define in dot data. We will point RDI to the D block. And for how many times the operation needs to be repeated, that is nothing but the counter, and as we have 7 values, so our counter will be 7. So what we have discussed in this logic, from RSI to AL we should transfer or we should move. So the instruction for that can be written as like this. Now square bracket, because we want value at this RSI. Next, from this AL to this RDI can write instruction like it should stored as a value at RDI from here. After the operation we will increment RSI by 1, we will increment RDI by 1, we will decrement our counter, and then till that counter becomes 0, we need to repeat from this instruction. So here we can give any label name. Suppose I am giving label name as back. So is the label name. And lastly return. So this procedure will help us to transfer the content from the source to the destination, right? Now second, after this source and destination is being available with us, the output part is what we need to display both the blocks. And for confirming that yes, really the block transfer has occurred, what we will do, we will display the blocks before transfer and after transfer as well, so that we will come to know really the data has been transferred or not. So we have this display procedure with us, which help us in displaying some digit number, and according to this, this display procedure is helping us to display 2-digit number. But if you consider this source block, then each individual element is of 2-digit. So to display single 10, I need to call display one time. And so similarly, second, third, up to this 7th value, if I want to display, then I need to call that display 7 times. And so what we will do, we will write some a separate procedure for displaying block itself, so that it can be a generalized procedure for every block, because sometimes we need to display source block, sometimes we need to display destination block. So it will be easy to display any kind of block. So now we'll write down or we'll discuss the procedure of how to display the block itself. So what overall logic can be in that display block procedure? Your display procedure should get called that many number of times. So just we'll see how to write that block display. Suppose I am giving the name block display. Okay. Now here, whatever counter we require, that is nothing but how many numbers are there in your source and destination block. And so we'll define that counter. So we have 7 values. And so I have defined the counter as 7. Now why we have taken RBP, the reason will be cleared after this 2-3 instructions. So what we will do now, suppose this block is available with us. So to display this single one, this we need to have in RAX, because display wants your number to be displayed in RAX. So once we take this number into RAX, then we can call display, right? So what we need to do, we need to access this block one by one, and that access is possible only with the help of RSI, because RSI is storing the addresses of that values. So at a time I can access a single value. So from RSI I should take it into accumulator, and then I should call the display. But again, if I call display, again I am using RSI, counter, then some of the register. So RSI is required two times, but at the same time, one for accessing the elements of this block and other for a individual digit from that number. So what we will do here, that conflict is occurred. To solve this, we will take the help of the stack. So what stack is basically used for? It is used to store the values for a temporary time period. So once we stored the, or once we use that RSI, we will store its value onto stack, and then we can use that RSI for some other purpose, and after that again you can resume the value by popping the value from the stack. Let's see how it will work. So initially what I am considering, RSI is now pointing to the block, so value at RSI should stored into AL. So as per our this block, 10 is now part of the AL. Okay. After that, immediately push your RSI onto stack. Means what, your stack is now containing the value 10. Now call your display procedure, because display procedure will help you to display this 10 digit. So 10 number will get displayed. Now after this, what we need to do, we need to again point to the next number. That number is nothing but 20. So to point to the 20, we need to increment RSI. So to get that RSI, because RSI is stored here, so we need to pop it out, and so we will write the instruction pop RSI from the stack and then increment your RSI by 1. Okay. And though we will decrement the counter, the reason we are using RBP because RCX is also RCX is already used in display procedure. Okay. So we'll decrement it, jump if not 0. So from where we need to repeat, from this statement we need to repeat. So here I will add some label, like next number suppose is the label. So where I should jump? I should jump to this label. So this procedure will help me in displaying the block, provided that block is pointed with RSI. Okay. So we have now three procedures with us: block transfer, then our block display, and then normal display. So display is already being called in block display procedure. Okay, now in section.txt, what we need to do, we need to display the content of the blocks before transfer as well as after transfer. In between, that block transfer will get called. Okay, so now we'll display the content. Before that, we'll require some of the messages, because from here we will start. So very first message will be something before the block transfer, the content of the source block. Okay. Suppose SMSG is, I am going to use. So this we need to define first in dot data. So here we'll define SMSG is the message. What it will store, it is referring that source block is, okay, and its length. Similarly, what we need to have, we need to have one destination message as well. So we'll call it as the destination message length. So destination block is, so 10 is for giving new line. Okay, so this is how we will use these two messages. So we'll first display the content of the block. After this, first we should point RSI to the S block, because we need to display the block, and we should call block display procedure. Okay, so this will help us in displaying source block. Similarly, destination block needs to be displayed. So first we'll display the message, then moving the content point D block with RSI, and then call display block, block display procedure. Okay. Now we'll call block transfer because we all already displayed the content. Now after block transfer, again we need to check the contents. So what we will do, again repeat the same. Display of source block and display of destination block. Okay. And then we'll come out of the execution mode. We'll see whether code is working or not. So let's see. Source block contains 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70. Only this is continuous because no, we have not displayed any space in between. So this is before block transfer and this is after block transfer. So our content is now getting transferred correctly. So we'll try to put the space in between. So how to add the space? Space is nothing but a input, single space input. So we'll define one variable with content one single space, and then where we want it, actually when this first number is being displayed. Okay, so after that number actually we require that space, so we will display space there as it is only one byte, so we'll write it like this. Just see whether it is working or not. Yes, so 10, 20 up to 70. So source block is being completely get copied into destination block. Okay, so this is the code where we have used normal move instruction to transfer the content from source block to the destination block. Now the same program can be implemented by using string instruction. So where we need to use the string instruction, so while transferring the data we can use the string instruction. So here, so while doing the block transfer you can use the string instruction. So which string instruction is available with us? Move s. So what move s is? Move the data string, move string, and again it can be modified as per the size of the data. Like if I write move sb, then I will able to transfer the data, string data, from source to the destination byte wise. So what move s is assuming? It is assuming that RSI and RDI are pointed to the appropriate locations. Okay, so if they are pointing to the appropriate location, then only you can use it. So let's try to use the string instruction. So first we will point RSI, RDI. Counter is required to repeat the iterations, and we are going to use the instruction move sb. Okay, so move s is for move the string, b stands for byte wise because our data, individual data, is of 1 byte. Now we need to perform this task repetitively, so we can use one of the prefix called as repeat. So what repeat prefix will do? It will repeat this operation and check the value of this counter. So after every successful operation it will decrement RSX by 1 and will check it with 0. If it is 0, then it will not repeat this task. If it is non-zero, then it will repeat this task. Okay, so whatever increment RSI, increment RDI part is, that is already being covered with this repeat. Content movement from RSI to AL, AL to RDI is being covered with move SB. Now remaining is what? RSI and RDI should get incremented. So for that we have again some instruction which works on the flag, direction flag. So direction flag DF, on that two instructions are there, CLD and STD. Clear the direction flag and set the direction flag. So clear means its value becomes 0, and you will always, you will miss RSI and RDI will always increment. Okay, and here we want RSI and RDI to be incremented. So here you can use the instruction CLD. So clear direction flag will help you in increment RSI and RDI value. Okay, so this complete program can be now restructured using string instruction. Okay, now we'll see whether it is working or not. Yes, see, you are getting this same output before block transfer and this is after block transfer. Okay, so this is how you can perform the block transfer using string instruction and without using string instruction.